Welcome to the Airbus How an Aircraft Knowledge Database Can Boost Aircraft Operations and Design session. So I'm just going to do a couple of housekeeping items before I turn it over to David to kick this off and introduce the speakers. But first, please, if you haven't already done so, download the mobile application. Hopefully you've done it by now. In the mobile app, there's a survey button. So please fill out those surveys. They're very, very useful to us. In fact, for every survey completed, we'll either donate money to a charity or enter you into a drawing to win $250 Amazon gift card. So you can win something from doing the surveys, but please do them for us. The other thing is, please mute your devices now out of respect for the speakers. And lastly, I'll say questions will be done at the end of the session. So let the speakers go through their part, and then you can ask questions. There'll be at least 10 or 15 minutes at the end to ask questions. If we have a lot of questions and we don't get them in, you can meet with the speakers afterwards, and they'll address your questions directly. But with that, I'd like to hand it off now to David Gourbet, who's going to introduce our speakers.
Thanks. So I'm David Gourbet. I don't know how many of you know me, but I run engineering at MarkLogic. I'm introducing this presentation. This is actually one of my favorite use cases. I love this use case, partly because the queries, as you'll see, are very, very interesting, intricate, complex. And I think it's really taking advantage of lots of different MarkLogic capabilities and our capability to do combinations of queries across multiple different domains. I don't know if there's another technology out there that could actually do these queries, so I'm pretty excited about it, and I hope you guys are too. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce the speakers. So we have Stéphane Nouzier, who is the head of aircraft data processing for Airbus. And accompanied by Laurent Pelletier, who is a test data processing expert at Airbus. And take it away. Yeah.
Okay, this is our storage robot. Do you know, Laurent, how many data we have? Because, to be honest, I don't know exactly how many we have. How many data in this?
4.5.
Oh, 4.5 what?
What?
4.5 what?
Ah, 4.5 petabytes.
You should explain, because petabyte, what does it mean?
Ah, you know, petabytes. One petabyte, it's 1,000 terabytes.
Wow.
It's 1,000,000 gigabytes. It's 1,000,000,000 megabytes. If you prefer, it's 6.5 millions of DVD. Or if you are older, I can translate it 3.5 inches floppy disk, if you want.
Yes, I want.
3 billion of wow. Floppy disk. To store that, you need 3 billion of floppy disk.
Do you okay. Okay. So, okay, you say that we have 4.5 petabytes in data.
Yeah.
Okay, it's a huge volume, sure. Are you able, Laurent, in this data to find for the A331 family one or several flights with the autopilot on, with crosswind in the airport, and based in Toulouse? Are you able?
Yes, we can. And we are able also to detect when the crew said that there is some strange oscillation, or there is a low speed at, during the approach, and so on. So you can detect a lot of things.
Wow. So, Laurent, who you
so,
are?
So, as David said, I'm Laurent Pelletier. I'm a test data expert for Airbus for now 20 years. So I was in charge since that to collect the data for the A380, the A400M, the military aircraft, and the A350. So I manage all this data. I was lucky.
And I'm Stéphane Nezier. I'm working as well like Laurent in Airbus. First part in customer services in the strategic department. I've created what we call the customer portals, what it was a web portal. And then I switched to the engineering part, working for an IT part of the company. We are delivering services, especially for flight tests and then for other specificities. And since 2 years, I'm now a lucky guy having this Brian team where Laurent is to manage these 4.5 petabytes and more. And this is quite a huge challenge. So today we will try to do two things. The first thing is that we'll explain to you what it's called EA, our application, what does it mean? And the biggest one is that I should take all of you awake because it's 2 o'clock and you should not sleep. So we'll check if some of you are, I see that on the back there are some guys who, yeah.
It's not nap time.
So before speaking about Mark Logic product and things like this, I just want to explain to you a little bit about Airbus, so maybe you want to know a little bit more. I guess, I hope, I wish for you that you have already enjoyed this type of aircraft. We, as I used to say, that we make it fly, so it's flying, probably it could be Airbus. So it's a big group, there are a lot of different division. Be aware that there is not only civil aircraft, there are well, military ones and helicopters. So it's a huge number of different machines. More and more in the future, they will have new ones. And well, so Laurent and me, we are more in the commercial aircraft, but we are working as well for our colleagues for helicopters as well and for defense in space. My favorite slide is the next one because I like these figures. Every 1.4 seconds, one Airbus aircraft is taking off. So that means there is a lot of aircraft flying in the world. Guess what? They are generating petabytes of data as well. And this is one of the key challenges. As said by Laurent, we are belonging to a part of the company called the flight test. So there is the engineering section. And on the engineering, there is the flight test department. So flight test, as it's called, it's made about the test around the aircraft. So mainly for the development of new ones, but not only, as well for each delivery. We test the aircraft before delivering to the customers. And as well for the lab tests on ground. So we collect as well a lot of data from that. Our mission is there, mainly is to ensure the safety, to get the maturity of the aircraft as soon as possible, reduce the lead time. We are part of the game. I'm usually say that we are the last designer and the first customers. So it's a tricky situation where you are just at the end of the chain of the designing and the manufacturing, and just before delivering, you need to ensure that the product is in the right shape. So you have all the shit behind, and you need to be in front of the customer to explain that everything is perfect, and it should be. And for sure, there is no compromise. So on this department, there is a special section called instrumentation, where we are coming from as well. We put on top of the aircraft some instrumentation. What is it? It's just sensors and things that we put on top of the normal one to measure a lot of things. And this instrumentation could be quite heavy, several tons sometimes.
Yes, for the A380 it was 25 tons of instrumentation.
Yeah. 430 kilometers of cables to put. So, and we can measure, I would say not anything, but a lot of things, vibration, temperature, icing, many things that we need to measure and then to show the reality. And you should retain that. Our instrumentation brings the data to reveal the truth. The objective of the data is not to be the data, it's just to find the right information within the data. So this is where we are generating this famous 4.5 petabytes.
And for instance, for the certification, we have to bring the evidence to the authorities that our aircraft is safe. So we have to bring the evidence. And sometimes we have to demonstrate also that we fly in the right condition to demonstrate that what we collect is the right thing. So for icing condition, we put a specific instrumentation just to detect that we are in icing condition before measuring that the aircraft is safe in icing condition. So it's quite complex, and the department have really specific skills to achieve that.
The issue we have is that more and more, since the beginning of the 80s, we are our instrumentation brings more and more data.
This is the story of my life, yes.
It's the story of your life, Laurent. The floppy disk were on this stage.
No, I was not in Airbus in 1987, but what we have to say is that it's a short story of the IT storage history. Storage history, because we until 2000, we record on aircraft with big 28 tracks tapes like that. Remember the movie of the 70s,
yeah,
with big drivers and big computers. So
same.
We record on that on tape like that until 2000, and it was easy at this period because the archive, you just put the tape on the shelf, and this is the archive.
Yeah.
And when you want to read, you take the tape and you put on the drive.
And we still have 7,000 of them.
And when I arrived in 2000, it was the preparation of the A380. And we moved to hard disk. So we record on board on hard disk. But you can't put your hard disk on a shelf. So how to archive the data collected? Then the main challenge when I arrived is to move the data from the hard disk recorded on board to something else and to be able to retrieve this data for further analysis. So it was the first step. And after that, we moved to modern solid state drive. So now on board, we have a small carriage containing up to 700 gigabytes of data for each flight. And at the end, in 30 years, the number of parameters collected was multiplied by 50. But at the end, the data archive was multiplied by 50 also. So now we collect for a flight test campaign to achieve the certification, roughly 500 terabytes of data. So this is a challenge.
Yeah. And the video is exploding the systems as well, because we take
25 cameras.
Exactly. So we have high resolution cameras. So the volume of the video is increasing a lot as well. So
and our friends of the sensors have new ideas, and now they are able to have more accurate sensors, yeah, more sensitive, and now we are able to put 8,000 sensors on a wing only. To achieve the performance of the aircraft and to measure, so we are able to put many sensors. But I'm not happy with that because that means that we will collect more and more data at the end.
So the trend is that we will have more and more data, sure. But before this revolution, before the big data revolution, we have some nice tools. You see that we are all Apple. We have some Apple as well. It's a joke, but it shows that it has been a revolution for the tools as well. What you should know to understand what's been just after is that usually when you want to test something, there is someone requesting what you call a flight test request. I need to test this system for anti-icing, for example. So he put this on the table, and then there are a lot of process to take it into account and to fly and to test it as expected. So each request means each flight, okay? So then you try to optimize grouping some of them, but for each flight request, there is a flight, okay? The problem is that there is no global view. There is no capacity to see if sometimes in the past we already did this test. You don't know. And maybe another specialist requests a test where the condition was perfectly accurate for you. But this you don't know as well. Okay? So for sure, we know, we knew and we know that we have flight a lot for nothing, or maybe we can
overlap flights.
Okay? Knowing that a flight could cost a lot, it's really impressive. And this is where we need, there is something missing in the systems. There is so many data, and we cannot find what we want within this volume. So the question we had 2 years ago is, can I find something in this data where I can retrieve what I'm looking for? That means what we call a test point already exists. This is the question we raised to the teams. Please have a look, because we might think that there is really added value on that. So, Laurent, are you able to create a Google search where I can find on this old, this is the tapes, all the tapes, something already existing?
Yes. We have done that. And I'm quite happy to say that we have created a data hub before coming here, because this morning I discovered that Airbus have created a data hub without knowing it was a data hub. So clearly, we have designed 2 years ago, we started this story 2 years ago, a digital assistant. It's clearly a data hub to be able to search all the test points on all these features.
Okay, so the objectives was quite simple. In fact, the objective, as I said, is to optimize the flight hours, knowing that usually it's between $15 to $20 per hour. If you optimize a little bit, you can gain a lot. The objective is as well to provide the operational data during the conception phase, because if you know when you are designing a new systems, how it behaves after in services, it changes drastically how you will concept the new one on the thing like this. You need to know how it's used to optimize the design, optimize the support, the maintenance, everything. So be able to retrieve the data from a system for all flights, for example, is really important. Then the maturity of the aircraft. As soon as you have the capacity to retrieve this information, you can tackle any issues you could have. And it's better to know at the beginning than at the end, for sure.
Clearly, we are able now to use each minute of flight for all the usage, because previously it was designed for a specific test point. Now we try to use all minutes of flight for everyone.
Because when you are flying, the so-called instrumentation is on for all. So maybe some of the sensors are just producing the data that nobody will take care, but this data is quite probably useful. And the last one is just to start to do predictive maintenance, but we need to do it. So the question is, okay, you can, but how will it work? So I've understood what you explained to me before, that we have the aircraft, so it's there, easy. There are three data sources. The first one, the sensors data, as I expect, something you put on top of the aircraft, plus what you retrieve from the aircraft itself, because each aircraft has some computers, they are exchanging each other, and this, you can take it and have all this data exchange, plus what has been reported by the flight crew and the other text things, handwriting things. But okay, it's very high level view. Laurent, I need to deep dive a little bit. Can you explain to me more in details around the sensor data, how you manage to do that?
Yeah. Yes, because for me, it's the main point, which is difficult in our case, is how to handle time series. Because all the sensors...
Laurent, time series, what is this?
Time series. Time series is the result of what is acquired by sensors on avionic buses. All the computers on an aircraft exchange information all along the flight. For instance, you can imagine that the autopilot sends information to the electrical command, Electrical command de vol.
Flight control.
Thank you, sorry. Between the autopilot and the flight control. So they exchange a lot of information, and it's clearly timestamp information, because they send perhaps the altitude, the maneuver to do, and so on. So it's a continuous signal. And in a continuous signal, physically, at the end, it's a time series. So the time series is a couple of time and value. And for us, unfortunately, we have 600,000 time series coming from the aircraft. So at the end, some of them are sampled to up to 8,000 points sampled per second. So one time series for 4 hours at this data rate, it's quite a nightmare to handle and to manipulate and so on. So to design a search engine, we don't need all the sample, because at the end, you don't care exactly the precision of the time. You just want to detect, does it happen? So does it happen? Do you reach this threshold? Do you reach and roughly know when it happened? Or roughly, not at the precision of the sample itself. So how would we design that? With a test specialist, we request to them how to reduce this time series. So you have two examples. Above, this is the altitude during a flight test, the altitude and the ground speed. And you see that we try to find an algorithm when we find time period when we say that the value is fixed. Instead of having the noise of the measurement, because when you are making a measurement with sensors, there is a noise, so two values are always different. So we find a way to filter that and to find time period where the signal is stable. So this is the algorithm we choose. And at the end, please, Stéphane, we reduce perhaps 1 million points to 10 value, because sometimes it's enough stable. So at the end, what we inject in MarkLogic platform is things like that, GMT start, GMT end, and the value corresponding. But it really drastically reduces the amount of data.
So you simplify
the signal. And when you know that 80% of the parameters are Booleans, Booleans are true or false. And we expect that it's quite stable, because massively, these Booleans mean alerts on problem on the aircraft. So you expect that it's always false. So during all the flights, perhaps the value is always false. Even if it's repeated each milliseconds, at the end, it's always false. So if you have a Boolean stable during all the flights, you have only one value injected in the database instead of all the samples. So it's a way to drastically reduce what we put. Okay. This is the time series.
OK, and this understood. If I come back, you have this one as well? You
can explain now? Trajectography, but it's because we use the capacity of MarkLogic with a geospatial capability. So we put the trajectography of the aircraft. But at the same time, it's not the trajectography each millisecond. We put a point each half a mile or something like that. It's enough to have roughly the trajectography of the aircraft. Another point, which is not obvious, but it's really important in our case, is to find which signal we want to use. Because 600,000 signals, you have to look at how it's called, what is the name of the good signals. When you want to share your data with more people, because currently in the test center, everyone knows the parameters, but we want to share with the design office, we want to share with the assembly line, we want to share the customer support, and these people don't know the FTI. So how they are able to retrieve the parameters? On an aircraft, the altitude, you see that the altitude, you can have up to 20, 30 altitude, because each system send my altitude is this one. I'm not agree with my the other system, so each system send its own altitude. So when you have to select a parameter, which one do you select? So we try to put in place a search engine also to enable the people to find the good parameter. Because what is tricky also is that depending on their job, people don't name the same signal with the same name. Don't ask me why. This is an old story, I think. But sometimes the design office say this altitude, we'll call it ZP. No. I want to call it Alt 1. Yes, but this is the same. No, I don't want to use the name of my colleague. So you have to merge all this naming convention.
Oh, you are speaking about ontology?
Yes.
Understood.
Yes, at the end, the ontology could help.
Okay, for the first part. The second part, can you explain a little bit more of this?
Second part is quite easier because it's quite classical. It's structured data. We have all SQL databases containing the configuration of the aircraft for each flight. And because we are testing aircraft from a test to another, we change something. Perhaps the version of the autopilot is not the same between two tests. So we have to retrieve which is the version of the test of the autopilot for this test. So we collect that in SQL database, but at the end we have to merge this information with the time series to be able to cross-find the information. So we collect all the aircraft configuration, the weather conditions, the airport, the runway use, what is the crew during the flight, and so on, and we put everything in the MarkLogic platform.
It's traditional MarkLogic integration.
Yes, it's quite more classical.
And this one?
My
colleagues, the flight crew, they like to handwrite some things to say
we still
that.
Have.
How you manage?
We don't manage everything at the moment. There is the report written on board is still unwritten. So at the moment, we are quite a problem with unwritten report because people are writing like your
doctor.
I don't know if your doctor have a good unwritten, but they use a lot of Segloom and so on. So to put in an OCR, it doesn't work. It doesn't give a lot of information. So the only document we are able to put in the database at the moment is what we call the flight crew report, which is typed by secretaries after the flight. So at the end, we put all these documents, which are docs, classical docs document, to be able to have the unstructured text. So we use the capability of MarkLogic with the plain text indexation, and we push all the documents like that. It could help also to retrieve the data.
Okay.
And ontology also, because sometimes different wording means the same thing. So we put ontology on that.
And at the end, all these three data sources are just merged and we are able to search like I want on this.
Now we push all this data, we inject all the data. Now we are able to create a front end to make the search engine itself.
Okay, understood. Maybe you can show a little bit some details because we are just no more time, but.
We tried to create a user-friendly GUI using drag and drop principle to help people to create flight test condition. Remember, Stefan request me autopilot on and vibration and oscillation.
Yeah.
And so how to make autopilot on? But you create a condition saying that this parameter is equal to true. So perhaps the autopilot from the first officer or the autopilot from the captain is engaged because there is two autopilot, one for the captain, one for the first officer. So you create a condition or one of the two parameters is, and perhaps you want to have another condition that the ground speed, you want to just select the landing where the ground speed is below a threshold. So it's an and you create the and here with a specific GUI. And for the document search, what Stefan said, we use ontology to be able to expand the research, because when you are searching in document, sometimes you have to expand the research, not only by the keyword given by the user, but by all the equivalents. So we put the ontology the exam for the altitude. There is many, many terms.
Okay. And the last one, to search around the airport?
Yes, because we use the capability of the geospatial capability of the database. So we are able to draw where you want to have the condition achieved. So you take a map, you just draw a polygon, and you say, I just want the event, autopilot and so on this runway, and just draw a shape around the
Understood, Laurent. So, okay, now...
So you create a complex request, query, and at the end, you get the result.
So we have the result, you mean? This is my result?
Yes.
Ah, okay. How many flights have?
I have six flights reaching the condition. Okay. And you have exactly the time period where your condition is achieved.
Okay.
And you can display that on a timeline, on a plot, on a map, saying that the event is right from this point, the bullet, to this bullet. Only on this part of the flight, your condition is true. And you can do a lot of things. And it's really the beginning
of
the workflow. Because at the end, when people find their condition, they know exactly it already happened first information. They can check a lot of condition around what happened on each time period. And after that, they can collect the time period and put that in an analytics workflow and to make machine learning and so on all the detected time period to start and to make algorithm, trends.
Understood. Well, so if I summarize, the benefits of the solution, it's based on Marc Logic for sure. We'll speak about that just after. It's easy to integrate, finally. Not so easy, but it's easy to integrate. The links between the object is quite useful because we can see which parameters is linked to the others. The temporal notion has been really important for us because, as explained by Laurent, the time series is really the hearth of our data, so we need to match this.
And it's perhaps the single thing we customize with Marc Logic, how to detect overlap event.
Yeah,
the time overlap is not a feature of Marc Logic. So we have designed a specific JavaScript to achieve the research matching overlap time period.
So we started the deployment in 2008, last year, I think, beginning of last year. It's still in deployment for sure. But this is not only a tool, it's as well a change of the process because as you can understand there is a big change. This is quite a revolution for the end users because before they were used to say, okay, I have this request, I have this flight, and they do flight by flight analysis, where now they can do multi-flight analysis, so they change drastically the way they can find issues and they can find data to get the maturity. This is really a step change. And this is an example of the digitalization where, in fact, what has been really changed is not only the tools, it's the way to work. Maybe some very short word about, I understood this today that we should say Marc Logic.
Marc Logic.
Where in France we say Marc Logic.
Marc Logic.
So, Laurent, your view as experts in 30 seconds.
About, 30 seconds.
Yeah.
2 points, powerful. This platform is powerful, but to achieve the capability of the platform, I think you need your team trained. It's not obvious to start with Marc Logic, it's not so obvious, so you need, it's mandatory to use expertise from Marc Logic. So because it's not, it's different from a SQL database. You have to think differently. So I think that you need expertise for Marc Logic to start. Because it's powerful, it's not so obvious.
If you have questions, this is the right time to ask questions.
So how long does it take to process a query that complex? How long do you have to wait to get results?
30 seconds.
And how long did it used to take you to find that answer?
Weeks.
weeks.
Weeks or months, because before you have to restore the data, to extract and so on.
Sometimes you cannot compare because before it was not possible.
The lead time is too huge, so it doesn't do the job.
What do you deploy on? Are you in the cloud or are you on-prem? Can you say?
Yes, we can. We are on the Amazon AWS. But the data is on-prem. So currently we are copying the data on Amazon. It's just an hosting solution.
Okay.
So, but it is that's why we are there, to see where are the future. Do we stay in premises or do we go on the cloud? On the data, for sure, we already did it finally, so we will manage to get it officially, but this is not a question. The question is, do we stay on premises with the advantage in the inconvenience, or do we go further on the cloud?
With managed services.
With managed services. This is an open question. We don't know. That's why we are there today to exchange.
Other questions?
So all 4.5 petabytes of data in MarkLogic or total, like, you know, relational plus MarkLogic is 4.5 petabytes?
Today, the volume that's being indexed in the data, it's very few. It's, I don't know, it's maybe, I don't know, 1 gigabyte, 2 gigabyte.
I didn't check before coming.
To be honest, it's really ridiculous because we only put some aircraft. That means
We are far from the 600,000 parameters at the
maybe
moment.
Maybe it's 1,000 parameters only, because the best one, I will say, and only some family aircraft, because we are on deployment phase. We need to show the added value. We need to convince our colleagues. So very few. To be honest, I think we are using 1% of the capacity of the systems.
I think even when you have all of the data in, it's still not, the 4.5 petabytes is all the sensor data, right? And you simplify that data with the event model.
4.5 is the total data we have for all flight tests since 22 February 87, first flight of the A320 up to this morning, okay? This is the volume we have. Then, on the DEA, we take a part of this volume, as said by Laurent. As soon as he put the algorithm, he reduced drastically the volume to get only the key points. So the volume decreased a lot.
Because the idea behind is to have a search engine and just to find what it is relevant. To make the fine-tuning and analysis, we will use our primary storage. Yeah. Which is a big data solution where all our time series are handled and so on, if you want to have a precise analysis. We don't want to put everything in MarkLogic. MarkLogic will help for a part of the workflow.
You can see it
workflow.
As a mega index. Then after we have the six flights. When you have the six flight, then after you can have the whole details if you want. And then you take it from the big data system. The MarkLogic system is there to find the right one. Over the millions of flights we have.
So, do we have those algorithms? Are they inside the MarkLogic or outside the MarkLogic?
Outside. On the big data itself, we have some algorithms to do some stuff. To convert, as was shown by Laurent, the signal, it's within MarkLogic. It's in the processing just before.
We do that in big data to make parallelism, so we are ready to index all of the amount of data, and we do that we're using Spark to reduce drastically.
So you need to say that all the data is in Hadoop Spark?
Yeah.
And you run the algorithms and bring the data in?
Yes. Yeah. We extract the good features we put in MarkLogic.
Yes.
So have you leveraged any MarkLogic and Hadoop integrations?
Not yet. We are thinking at the moment with NiFi. To help to make the transition and so on. Because we are working in batch mode, because we receive the data on each test after the test. So we receive massive data twice a day after each flight. So it's clearly the batch processing for it. It's not real time.
So what is the MarkLogic
I don't know. I didn't check, sorry for that, but I didn't check before.
I think for some use case I heard, very small. I don't know. We need to check, to be honest. For sure, very small comparing to other customers.
I think, yes, yeah. But...
I don't know. I think some gigabyte, maybe. The query, you mean? It's the natural
XQuery.
XQuery.
We are using XQuery and the search capability of MarkLogic directly.
The only thing that is not the official MarkLogic system is the algorithms to traduce this time series in such a simplified value. All the rest is just using the MarkLogic.
So the front end you saw is quite simple because behind everything is done by the database itself.
Yeah.
So you just create the query, like you. It's not no SQL because it's to have a search capability. And I don't remember if we use the search capability of the XQuery. What is the API we use? Mm, yeah. One of the three APIs of MarkLogic we are using to request. But at the end, we are able to make really complex query. The front end is designed in Angular.
Yeah, in Angular, yeah. There is a question on that, yeah.
Is the long-term vision that MarkLogic and the Hadoop components would continue to work complementary, or would MarkLogic end up
replacing? You know, in France, we say you don't put all your eggs in the same box. Well, it's the same. First, these different needs coverage. The big data is managing terabytes and terabytes of data, there are some post-processing systems. There are all the legacy tools connected on that. Logic is more an opportunity to cover what we showed today, plus some poor application based on SQL, because at the time, there is no question. Each time you have a need, you put an SQL database, and then now you recognize that this was not a good idea. So it's more an opportunity, and it's growing up. There is no strategy to cover everything or thing like this because first we have no money for that, and second I need to have some use cases to get the value. So, it's more
complementary.
Yes, it's complementary. Sure.
But we are quite interested by the multi-model of MarkLogic document and graph. And graph for us could be really helpful for the aircraft configuration, the flight test installation configuration, and so on because it's clearly a graph. With dependency, so the triple store of MarkLogic is really important for us, and we have a lot of ideas. And I think for the future, it will be an opportunity instead of using SQL database, which are not designed for that. And
we have more
we suffer
use case to manage to test than time and money to do. So.
Why? Because the capability of when we select that, it was for us, it's clearly the search capability of the database was really interesting. This is a key point for us, is what is integrated. We are geospatial research, you are bitemporal capability also, which are, we have ideas regarding the big bitemporal capability of the database, and we have a lot of ideas. So for us, it's a good tool, and quite easy to integrate data in it. When we first
connectors, so you can connect quite any source of
different
data.
Index types. So we discovered there's many types of indexation. The easy to put plain text document without any trouble. So it's a trade-off between doing everything by ourselves using open source on Adobe and so on, or using a tool which is designed and maintained and supported.
Yeah.
So you said you implemented Data Hub even before you heard about that. Is there any plan to actually come on board with the MarkLogic's Data Hub sort of
We discussed this morning about that. What will be our strategy? We don't know exactly because we have to compromise with a global Airbus strategy also. Because we are not IT guys, we are business. So we push a product, but at the same time, the IT guys of Airbus are thinking about data lake and solutions. So we have to make the trade-off. So perhaps we will still, Data Hub could be helpful, but if it's not the good direction.
It will depend how we will explain this to our colleague.
Just on a lighter note, you are discussing whether you should be on the premises or on cloud.
Yeah.
Being Airbus, it's better be on cloud, right?
Okay, we'll do one more question.
There is a question on the
and,
back,
and
yeah.
Again, if you have questions that weren't answered, you can
yeah.
ask them directly yeah. after the session.
We are available just after, no problem.
All right, thank you. I wondered regarding sensors, would a sensor that's weakening but still operating be notified to the pilot that it's in that condition, or is it simply a sensor that has failed? There's a difference between the two types of problems. I wondered how specific is the information that's being relayed to them.
The aircraft itself has its own sensor,
yeah.
and the instrument. It has its own instrumentation. But to be able to compare and to calibrate the aircraft itself, we add other sensors to be able to calibrate the aircraft. For instance, you have to know during the first flight, the anemometry calibrations to know exactly the speed of the aircraft in the air is not known. So the first time they are flying, this is because the skill of the pilot, they are able to pilot. So the first flight is to calibrate the real sensor of the aircraft comparing to what we add with our instrumentation. And we are working, another point is also to say that at the moment, because we are in the real world, we are working on data qualification. And we will put all the data, this information in data lake, in the MarkLogic, I think, platform, I think, is because, is it a problem of the sensor, of the measurement chain, or a problem of the aircraft itself? And to answer to that, it's not obvious,
no.
because sometimes there is something going wrong, but is it because your sensor, there is a mistake with your sensor, with the measurement chain, or because it's really a problem you have to look at because this is a problem of the aircraft itself. In the flight test department, it's really tricky to separate the normal of the abnormal.
Most of this data is for guys on ground waiting for their data because they have asked for a test. During the flight, there is the flight test engineer. He is the boss of the aircraft.
So where
the pilot are just there to execute what he is saying. And these guys, he's on the middle of the aircraft. He has a full station with a lot of parameters displayed. And
in real time.
In real time. So he can follow and check what is ongoing during the test. And then he takes all the requests he has to pass, and he goes one after one.
And then if something is wrong,
he
comes back home and we check the aircraft because some of the tests are can be destructive for the aircraft. So sometimes
That's why the quality of the data is quite key. If you measure the wrong things, it could be dangerous. So it's something that we need to take care of. And you have a lot of data everywhere. But what is important is not the data. Is as I said, is the information within the data.
Okay, thank you. As a reminder, please complete your surveys for the session. And thank you for joining today.
Thank you.